conversation, we're actually going to forego the community song, which I know is in your program, so we're deviating from a great turnout this morning, which I imagine is because many of you heard about our topic and the author that we have here to speak, and that brought you in, which is really fantastic. This is the most people I think I've seen in being a member of participant here for the last couple of years. So it's really exciting to see such a great turnout. We also didn't have a marathon today, so it's a lot easier to get here than maybe it was last Sunday. So it's my pleasure to get to introduce our speaker and the moderator for the conversation. So our own leader, Dr. Joe Chuman, will be doing the interview this morning. And just to briefly introduce Joe, he's been a leader of Ethical Society of Bergen County since 1974. And since 2008, he served as a part-time leader here at the New York Society. And he speaks here often, so if you ever want to come back and hear Dr. Chuman speak, he's a great speaker. We always learn something from him. He's the president of the Bergen County Sanctuary for Asylum Seekers, which is founded by the Ethical Culture Society of Bergen County. He also teaches human rights at the graduate level at Columbia University. He's published numerous articles that have been in the Record of Bergen County, New Jersey, the New York Times, The Humanist, Free Inquiry, Humanistic Judaism, and other periodicals. He also has articles published on ethical culture and religion in several encyclopedias. And so Joe will be joining us on stage to interview our guest speaker this morning, who is Steven Hassan. Steven Hassan is a mental health professional who specializes in helping people recover from mind control, as well as helping loved ones to exit without coercion. He's been helping people leave destructive relationships and organizations since 1976, after he was rescued from an infamous cult, the Loonies. Hassan directs the Freedom of Mind Resource Center, which is a counseling and publishing organization outside of Boston. Teaches at Harvard Medical School and Brigham and Women's Hospital, and is pursuing a doctorate from Fielding University. He's the author of several books, including Combating Cult Mind Control, Releasing the Bonds of Freedom of Mind, Helping Loved Ones Leave Controlling People, Cults, and Beliefs. He also has a TEDx talk, which I would encourage you to check out online. It's really interesting, and I think it's a good overview of a lot about what he speaks about and writes about. So now I'd like to welcome Dr. Chuman and Steve Hassan to the stage.
Great to have you, Steve. Boy, now we know what we have to do to get people out. Come back next week. I want to thank Monica Weiss for bringing Steve Hassan to us. Thank you, Monica. Let me start off by saying, obviously, a lot of political pundits and commentators have tried to explain the Trump phenomenon, which seems so counter-rational, especially for people in this group. We pride ourselves on our rationalism and generally our liberal outlook on life. And the Trump phenomenon really does require explanation. Occasionally, the pundits will mention in passing that Trump is a type of cult figure, and that's one possible explanation for his appeal, but seldom is there any analysis. And we have to thank Steve Hassan for filling in that gap, basically, by providing an analysis of Donald Trump as a cult figure. And I have a zillion questions to ask you today. You do say up front in your biography that you yourself were ensnared at one point by the Moon organization. And you don't have to be more personal than you want to be, but we can't avoid talking about that biographically. Can you tell us what your experience was, how old you were, and if you will, how psychologically you were disposed to being vulnerable to being essentially dragooned into the Moon organization?
Sure, yeah. And the one thing we haven't mentioned yet is the book
Came out
by Simon & Schuster.
By the way, this is the book.
Is what I would like people to consider
purchasing, right? You don't have to say it. I'm sure the book is for sale. It's a book
reason
free.
The other ones.
It's comprehensive.
This
okay.
one is really, hopefully, going to give you hope about what's going on, because it will offer a frame of understanding that will not be black and white, all or nothing, good versus evil frame, but a frame of understanding the psychology of mind control healthy mind control, where you're controlling your own mind, and unethical mind control, where destructive authoritarian people are manipulating, deceiving, and controlling behavior, information, thoughts, and emotions to make people dependent and obedient. So I'm going to answer your question, but I really want to create the frame of why this is so important. And I want to thank Monica Weiss, who is literally the girl next door for me, my oldest friend. And we grew up 1.3 miles from Donald Trump. We were in Flushing, and this is Jamaica States, the rich part. And she witnessed my recruitment into the Moon Cult at Queens College in 1974. I was an upper junior creative writing major. Had my hair in a ponytail, work boots. I was writing poetry and short stories. That was my career path. And my girlfriend dumped me. This is the answer to your question. My girlfriend dumped me. I was lonely. I was down. And three women who were pretending to be students at Queens College smiled at me and flirted with me and asked if they could sit at my cafeteria table at the student union, and that began my recruitment into a right-wing fascist cult that wanted to take over the world, establish a theocracy. Korea would be the master race. As a conservative Jew, I was indoctrinated to believe the Holocaust was necessary because the Jews didn't accept Jesus, and all kinds of other doctrines that the public does not know about. How many people have heard of the Washington Times newspaper? Did you know the movies on that?
Yes.
Okay, most people don't. And I have a list on my website, freedomofmind.com, of friend groups that go 71 pages single-spaced of my former cult that is still operating today. So the point I want to make, the general point, is that there's a very important concept in social psychology called the fundamental attribution error. Raise your hand if you've ever heard of that term. A few of you. What it means is when we look at other humans and try to figure out why they're doing what they are doing, we over-attribute personality variables or dispositional variables, and we underestimate the social environmental forces. We have a bias. So in other words, how could Steve get into the Mooney cult? He was weak, he was stupid, he was gullible, he didn't have a good religious education, his family was dysfunctional, whatever. And I'm here to tell you, having been rescued by my family, and some of my family members are here, I was a good guy trying to improve myself and make the world a better place. That was my vulnerability. And the biggest vulnerability was lack of education about how psychology can be used in a systematic way to break you down and create a new pseudo-identity that is dependent and obedient to some authority figure or group. And I see a few heads nodding, so maybe you were raised in a cult or have an experience in a cult, because that's how a lot of people know me, through my books that first came out in 1988. But I really wanted to start this interview with stating that there's still a public ignorance about people who are susceptible to getting into mind control cults. The answer is, if you're breathing, you're susceptible. If you're alive, if you want to improve yourself, you want to make the world a better place, if you fall in love with the wrong person, you're vulnerable. But knowledge is power, and that's what my whole life work has been about, is giving information that empowers people to think for themselves and make their own decisions. And there's one message I'll come back to, and I know you're going to ask me more, but there's one message I want to beg you to consider, listening to my story, is stop labeling Trump believers as stupid, ignorant, dumb, evil, and putting them down. That's what people did to me when I was in the Moon cult. That's what people do to people in Scientology, Jehovah's Witnesses, a million other cult groups, it just reinforces the mindset that you're being persecuted, and it doesn't provide an avenue for helping them to get in touch with their true self, to start thinking rationally, to look at human rights, to look at what's true, what are the facts? Because when I'm helping people exit a cult, I'm showing them facts. I'm often using literature from their own organization. I'm bringing former leaders from that organization to help explain facts. And people deep down inside do not want to be lied to. They don't want to be exploited. Understand that. And so there is hope, but we've got to stop this polarization. We've got to get educated about how other cults work. And with Trumpers, I'm jumping ahead, forgive me, Joe, but the two things to talk about people who are Trumpers about is Chinese communist brainwashing, which they all admit is happening. Over a million Muslims and other people are being in government-run programs right now. And trafficking, sex trafficking and labor trafficking entities. They will talk to you about those subjects. Don't talk about Trump as a cult person at first. Talk about things that they can relate to, and then break it down into the subcomponents: behavior control, information control, thought control, and emotional control. And with that as a common ground, I know I'm jumping ahead.
Yes, forgive me. I thought we'd deal with that at the end.
Sorry. I apologize.
Right, that was your interview. We do want to talk, of course, about Donald Trump and the Trump phenomenon, but I really have to ask you one more personal question. I should say, I'm an alumnus at Queens College.
All right.
Class of 1968, and I was never approached by three attractive women. For a few minutes, you were ahead of me there. I want to press you on something. Generally, the stereotype assumption of people, particularly young people who are vulnerable to cults, is that they are, in some sense, troubled. They are alienated. They are lost. They don't have a sense of purpose or direction in their life. They're, to use the technical term, they're deracinated. They don't have roots, and so on and so forth. Is there a particular profile, and then, in fact, cult recruiters are particularly sensitive to being able to identify those types that are most vulnerable towards recruitment? Is there a type in that regard? But you seem to deny that fact. You seem to say that anybody is vulnerable in that regard.
So
I'm wondering if some people are more vulnerable than others.
Yes, so I would say the situational vulnerabilities, like my girlfriend dumping me and women approaching me, was a big one. I already mentioned the biggest vulnerability was ignorance about how cults and mind control operate. Death of a loved one, moving to a new city, state, or country, illness, something that throws you off balance. Those are the categorical ones. And I would also say people who of any age are being recruited, whether it's a multi-level marketing cult, whether it's a personality cult of a narcissistic controlling person who takes you over and isolates you from your family and friends, takes over your finances. And then as a mental health professional, I would say, yes, there are high hypnotizable people who are genetically gifted to be able to have a very high imagination ability and concentration ability, which is not a bad thing. Most of the most successful people have that ability. But there's a susceptibility to someone who knows how to exploit that capacity. Do you want me to explain a little bit more what I just meant by that? So there's a bell-shaped curve. High hypnotizables are here. Most people go in and out of trance states, but within a normal range, there are some people who are not hypnotizable. They're very concrete, often psychotic and schizophrenic. But if you can visualize yourself shooting a free throw and seeing the ball in your mind going through the net, that is a high trance capacity. It's called visual hallucination and kinesthetic hallucination, to be able to do that. If you have the capacity to make things disappear, like you're in a crowded, you know, coffee shop, and you're focusing on your work, and you don't hear anything, that is a demonstration of a high capacity of hypnosis. In other words, it's not a weakness, it's just the sidestepping of our analytic, critical thinking into a deeper zone of functioning. So I would say that is probably the genetic vulnerability for people.
Okay, yeah, I want to move on. You know, sometimes you give a very...
More concise.
Yes, that's right. You give a very detailed analysis and description of what a cult is. And I do want to focus on that. I want to ask
Please.
You to define what a cult is, but particularly tell us how a cult differentiates from mainline religions. The United States has perhaps thousands, I'd like to say the United States has thousands of religions, half of them in California. Many of them are highly conservative religions, very conservative, where the religious leader, the pastor, or the priest has a great deal of authority, where the disposition of the followers is one, I think, of Hasidic Jews in Brooklyn, where the power of the Rebbe to basically tell people how to vote, for example, and how to believe is very, very powerful. And this is true of many conservative groups where a great deal of, again, authority is vested in the religious leader, and you have followers, and the leader is understood sometimes to have a pipeline to the divine, and so on and so forth.
Right.
So the question I'm asking is, it seems to me definition is important here.
Yep.
How does what you're calling a cult, which of course has a very negative valence, differ from, let's say, highly conservative authoritarian religions, which the American public, although they may not like if they're liberals, may indeed identify as bona fide legitimate religious practices. It seems to me that there's a gray zone basically between those phenomena. And I'm wondering, but I think it's very important to try to draw as clear a definition as we can.
Yeah, absolutely.
Even though it may not be possible. I'm wondering.
Oh, it absolutely is. And I write about it in all my books, actually. So I have a different view of, in terms of this whole phenomenon. And the way I think about things is on an influence continuum from ethical influence, and ethical culture, society is over here, and destructive mind control groups.
Well, I'm glad you said that, because the minds of people don't know us very well because of our name. Some people think we're a cult.
Well, so, but what I'm trying to say is that when I use the word cult, like if you go on my blogs, you see a blog where I said, I joined the cult of Ted. You know, I was in a book called The Cult of Mac, when the author was writing about people who love Apple products and such. So when I think of cults, I think of ethical, benign, productive groups where you're really into it, but there's informed consent, you know what you're getting into, you have freedom of access of information and critics so that you can think for yourself. You're allowed and encouraged to question the authority. In terms of organizations, there's ethical checks and balances, accountability from leadership, leadership who admits when they make a mistake. So there are, if I had a blow up, I would show you my continuum, but if you go to Freedom of Mind, you can see it, or you can see it in my books. So therefore, I start with a very important premise in my work, which is that human rights demand and freedom of religion demands freedom of mind first. If you don't have the freedom to think for yourself, to be in touch with your own conscience, your own analytic ability, the ability to have the freedom to leave a group because you have so much fear, or what I call phobia indoctrination, of the irrational fears that terrible things are going to happen to you if you leave. If you don't have that freedom, you're in a destructive cult. Therefore, and then I have this model I refer to as the BITE model of mind control, also on my Freedom of Mind .com website. Behavior control is the B. So sleep deprivation is a big behavior control mechanism of mind control cults. When you look at most Americans, how many people are sleeping 7 to 9 hours a night and waking up refreshed? How many are sleeping? 7 to 9. So, but the brain and the mind needs good sleep to think clearly and to analyze. My sister-in-law is a neuropsychologist and a sleep specialist. He needed help in New York. No, just kidding. But under behavior control, you might have clothing you have to wear. At the moment, I'm blocking on all of my criteria, but they're all out there in terms of behavior control, information control, thought control, and emotional control. And I say, if it's a Jewish group that's doing it, if it's a Christian group that's doing it, a Muslim group, an atheist group, if it quacks like a duck and walks like a duck and it feathers like a duck, think of it as a duck. So that's, okay,
yeah,
that's my answer.
You want to move on, of course, what the gist of the book is, and that is a phenomenon. But one more question here. It seems to me, and I think correctly so, that you're talking about the retention of individual agency to make choice within the context of, let's say, even a conservative religious environment is critical towards not being a cultic environment. But one thing you don't deal with in your book, and I want this is a bit of a challenge here. People do leave cults. And they don't, may not be, well, yeah, you have to be the difference of others. I suspect there are people who, in effect, drift away. And I'm wondering, and they do that because they make a choice at some point, for whatever reasons, that being in the cult no longer satisfies in some sense. Or maybe, how long do people who are ensnared in cults actually remain in them? And how many people who do become ensnared actually find their way out of cults through their own initiative over time?
I don't have an answer to that statistically, but I can tell you that having been doing this work for 43 years, I'd say the overwhelming number are people who exit without a formal intervention, a programming, a counseling situation. But the variables of if when you examine their story is really contact with the outside world that's loving and respectful and thoughtful and kind. Some of my friends who are in neo-Nazi hate groups all describe interacting with people who were treating them thoughtfully, kindly, respectfully, feeding them. The son of Black, Derek Black, I believe it was, left the neo-Nazi, growing up in a neo-Nazi environment because he met a Jewish person in college who invited him for Shabbat dinner. And he realized these are human beings and they're nice and they're friendly and they're helping me. So again, it goes back to the initial theme that I was wanted to get out front, which is if we're not gonna end the polarization by fighting and demonizing the other, we really have to understand that minds do shift and exit, but the variables that help them to leave. The biggest one, Joe, and I write about it in my book, is learning about another cult, you know, one that isn't pushing all their buttons, all their programming, and going, hey, that's just like my experience. And when I wrote this book initially in 1988, I started hearing from thousands of people all over the world from groups I'd never heard of. But they said, I read your book and it woke me up. And I exited. One fellow who was in the headquarters of the Jehovah's Witnesses, he's like, how come you didn't mention the Watchtower? And I was like, why? And he's like, are you kidding? I underlined the entire book. I said, teach me. And so I started learning about the systems within the Watchtower as a mind-controlling, destructive cult.
Okay, let's move on to Donald Trump, which is really racist.
Please.
Yeah, okay. You basically portray Trump in great detail as a cult figure, as a cult leader who uses techniques that overlap with, in effect, known cult leaders. You talk about Jim Jones, L. Ron Hubbard, Lyndon LaRouche. There's apparently about a half a dozen nefarious actors whom you basically cite at great length and say that Trump really can take his place in many ways among these in terms of technique. Why don't you describe this kind of thing?
So there are two parts to that. First, I would start with the stereotypical profile of destructive cult leaders is is malignant narcissism. So it's not just flagrant narcissism, which says, I'm the center of the universe, I'm smarter than everybody else, someone who doesn't take responsibility for their mistakes or errors or the harm that they do, someone who lacks empathy, someone who's a pathological liar. But it adds the malignant sociopathic thing of sadism and paranoia and extreme amounts of control and more. So I make that case, I think, very strongly in the Cult of Trump book. And then there are the specific techniques of manipulation, and the number one thing is lying. And lying from someone who's an authority figure typically will induce confusion in the average person's mind. Because how could he say it if it wasn't true? But think back to Adolf Hitler and Goebbels. They would tell lies all the time, and they realized the bigger the lie, the more it would be believed. And they were taking advantage of something called cognitive dissonance theory. So in my book, I trace the work of Edward Bernays, who wrote the first book called Propaganda in 1928, and who was hired by the tobacco industry to get women to smoke cigarettes and participated in the first presidential election. He was the first person to connect psychology with politics and finances. And again, the point that I'm trying to get to is that the knowledge of how the mind works, and now we live in the digital age, I would add, by understanding what pushes human beings' buttons, unless people understand we're all vulnerable, we have an unconscious that gets triggered, that and we need to use our analytic mind and look at facts, we're susceptible to all kinds of propaganda, disinformation, and other things like that. One of the techniques I talk about, behavior control techniques, information control techniques, thought control techniques, and emotional techniques. The universal technique I want to emphasize, I think I mentioned it a moment ago, is phobia indoctrination. The implantation of irrational fear. So when I was in the moon cult, I couldn't imagine leaving the group and being happy and fulfilled. I couldn't imagine leaving the group having a belief in God or having hope in the future of the universe without Moon. And when I got out of the group through a deprogramming effort of my family, and I started learning about Chinese communist brainwashing techniques and saw that it was a perfect fit for the Moon cult, I remembered the point where I turned off my critical thinking in my recruitment in the Moonies was when I was taken to see the Exorcist movie in 1974, and Moon gave a lecture to us saying, this movie is a prophecy by God of what will happen to you if you leave the Unification Church. And I was sleeping 3 to 4 hours a night, 7 days a week, cut off from my family, and I accepted that indoctrination. And it kept propelling me, doing all kinds of antisocial, unethical things in the Moonies, including fasting for Richard Nixon during his impeachment, because Moon said God wants Nixon to be president, which is an exact parallel of what's happening with millions of Americans who consider themselves Christians, believing God is using Trump in this day and age, and therefore demands our blind obedience.
Yeah, I want to get to that, but a little bit further on. According to polls, Trump consistently commands about 40% of the American public. But I know from a fact, knowing a few people, not many who follow Trump, there are multiple reasons why people support Donald Trump. For example, I know one very wealthy financier who voted for Donald Trump because he thinks he's going to fatten stock portfolios. Some people may do it because they like his political positions on abortion and on gun rights and so on and so forth. In other words, there are multiple reasons
exactly as
to why people have supported Donald Trump. So the question I have to ask you is, when you talk about the cultic dynamic Trump and his followers, let's look at his followers for a minute. What percentage of those 40 million do you think are indeed involved in the cult, psychologically in the cult phenomenon, as opposed to others who may be supporting Donald Trump for a whole range of reasons, including political proclivities? Or maybe they've always been a Republican and they simply vote Republican.
Yes.
I mean, there are a lot
I
of
write about that too.
Right, supporting Trump. So, and you don't see in the book, to be honest, I don't think there was that much discussion about other motivations for supporting Trump. You talk about other organizations, but I'm curious as to how large do you think.
I do not think it's a binary or nothing or monolithic whatsoever. And I think a lot of people voted for Donald Trump because they didn't want to vote for Hillary Clinton, period. They thought, you know what? The system is so corrupt, any outside change will be better. And I've talked with people who voted for Trump, of course, when it was ever since the election. I wish I had brought blow-ups of the graphics that are in the volume of The Cult of Trump, and it is on my website. But a typical cult structure is a pyramid structure with fringe members and circles emanating from the base. And so the vast majority in any, like the Moonies, the vast number of believers are out in the fringe, what I call the fringe versus the core true believers who would die on command or would watch him shoot someone on Fifth Avenue and say, go for it, you know, a great thing. But it's the people that concern me the most are the people who are in cults themselves, and there are people in the Moonies who are supporters of Trump and Scientology and other cults. But I write about a group called The Family. How many people have heard of Jeffrey Charlotte's work? There's a Netflix docuseries based on his two best-selling books. And this was a group that the Moonies were involved with. In fact, right after the National Prayer Breakfast, Moon was ushered to the White House, and that's when the deal was made that Moonies would be fasting and doing all kinds of activities for Nixon. And Michael Pence was recruited into this cult by Chuck Colson, who was a criminal from Watergate. And that's a whole another subject to talk about. I talk about Opus Dei in the group as well, and I came to understand that Attorney General Barr was on the board of directors of the Catholic Information Center in DC, which is a prelature of Opus Dei, a group that I have counseled people out of. Opus Dei, Catholic right-wing cult. Then I talk about a collection of churches, cults, in my opinion, called New Apostolic Reformation. These are groups where the leader says they're either an apostle or a prophet, getting direct revelations from God, where they speak in tongues, cast out demons, do faith healings, have people fasting and praying all night long, and these are high-tech spiritual warriors, their words, and there are at least 10 million Americans in a variety of these organizations that are completely believing God is using Trump. We just read in the paper Paula White is now working for the White House, and she's quoted as saying, I couldn't say, saying no to Donald Trump would be equivalent to saying no to God. Paula White, prosperity minister. I write in the book about Trump growing up in the Church of Norman Vincent Peale. So he was trained to do thought stopping very early and to believe. If you just believe 100%, magically things are going to happen for you in a good way, and doubting is a sin. So this connection between his childhood's indoctrination and what is happening right now is very prevalent. But I do want to agree with you 100%. There are many people who are simply using Trump for their own greed, their own immoral, criminal behavior. All the research I've done, including reading the Mueller report, it's clear that Putin is using and influencing Trump, and I think time will tell but the facts will come out. Beyond the Mueller report is more than enough to demonstrate that. And then I talk about other organizations and buy-ins. The thing that's one of the things that I really have as a thesis in the Cult of Trump book is that a lot of these right-wing Christian-esque groups that I consider to be destructive cults are trying to undermine the separation of church and state. They are doing a deliberate program called Project Blitz in local communities, trying to get people on local boards in order to undermine women's right to choose, undermine gay rights, and impose their vision that America is a white Christian nation on the rest of us. And it is absolutely vital that we understand that these very well-funded, very organized groups wanting to subvert our democracy and to undermine the rule of law and our constitution. And so therefore, we need to stop operating on this level and start thinking strategically about hope and what can we do to make things better and to not only not re-elect Donald Trump, but also how to bring people together again in the spirit of human rights and democracy and love and goodness.
Yeah, okay, I want to pick up on something that you just said.
Please.
It seems to me that your analysis in some ways is twofold. One could make the argument that those people who, let's say, go to Trump rallies and are his followers and so forth, are in effect caught up in the cult of dynamic. But here you're also mentioning other organizations which are not necessarily political. They are religious organizations which are also cults, in your view, that are effectively doing, almost as surrogates, are doing Trump's work for him and become byways towards support for Donald Trump. So it's a type of two-layered analysis, those who are directly influenced and those who are influenced perhaps somewhat indirectly through their involvement in another cult group that also supports Donald Trump.
Yes, so Chapter 7 are the controllers of Trump and who is running this and who are the followers, and they're not necessarily the same.
Okay, I want to pick up also, and this involves a nuance. I'm very interested in hair splitting psychologically here because I think it's...
You're an academic, it's your job.
Well, I'm an academic, that's what I do. But
I'm in a doctoral program, I learned.
Hopefully not stuck in the ivory tower. The question to my mind is important and intriguing. You watch CNN or MSNBC or whatever, you watch stuff or Fox News, and in effect, there are multiple reasons why, given political and economic reasons as to why people follow Trump. That is, the doors of economic opportunity have been closed to them, that there is anxiety over changing American demographics. America doesn't look the same as more and more immigrants move into your neighborhood. There's the feeling and the anger that people's lives in the South and in the mountain states are really controlled by East Coast elites. A great deal, and I put a great deal of stock in this, is that we've developed a sense of political tribalism, that people feel, in effect, part of a group based around not only their ethnicity and their religion, but these days around political issues. I mean, gun control, abortion rights, and so on. It's created a type of tribalistic affinity among people, and so on and so forth. Given that all these analyses have truth to them, assuming that they're all valid analyses, how does the cultic phenomenon, this is a very nuanced response, I guess, how does the cultic mindset or psychology, how is that factored into and meshed with all these other motivations that are political, economic, sociological, and so forth? Do you have a sense of that?
Oh, I do, very much so. So I want to state another thing that I learned in researching the Cult of Trump book, which is a concept called fourth generation warfare. It's a psyops term that was invented in the 1980s by an American military strategist named William Lind. And it's basically psychological warfare to disorient, confuse, to alienate people from one another, to get them to distrust truth, to delegitimize leadership and delegitimize institutions. So how do you delegitimize institutions? You take someone who's against the EPA and put them in charge of the EPA. Think about it. You take someone who doesn't believe in public education, someone who made billions of dollars off of multi-level marketing, and put them in charge of education. So we need to understand we're living on a planet together, and there are other countries that really want the demise of the United States, particularly dictators and authoritarian regimes around the world do not like America saying, hey, human rights matter. They do not want our prestige, they do not want us to have power, and they've been embarking online on psychological warfare. And our media is only looking at how much money are we making. If we're getting good ratings, we'll keep on broadcasting the messaging that's undermining our democracy. And so I really, again, knowledge is power. And if you understand this is intentional undermining of facts and truth and science, and the thing that's enabled the human species to evolve to such an amazing level that we live today is because of science and because of testing, because of fact checking, and not because of believing authoritarians who want to sell fossil fuels or authoritarians who want to sell weapons. You know, who's stockpiling assault rifles? People who listen to Alex Jones, Fox News. I talk in my book about how did we get to the place where we are now. Trump took away the Johnson Amendment, making it perfectly fine for churches to do political work without any fear of the IRS. They voted away the public good function when mass media was first created, so that anyone who has money can buy a network like TBN, the Trinity Broadcasting Network, which is the largest religious broadcasting in the world, and they're doing Trump propaganda. One of the things that's so different from my involvement with the moon cult are smartphones. And people are deliberately getting triggered intentionally by different platforms that want to make money doing advertising revenue, and they're measuring how much time you're spending on each app. And this information is all being collected because we don't have any data protection laws in place, which is really frightening. But the point that I want to emphasize is love works, respect works, truth matters, and the people, like, think about it. If you're a family member and your loved one gets into Scientology or some other cult, and I've lived this for 43 years, the normal reaction is to yell at your loved one, wake up, it's a cult, what's wrong with you? Can't you see this person's abusing you? Blah, blah, blah. And it just drives the person deeper into their indoctrination. It doesn't work. But help me understand, you used to be like this, and now you're like this. Walk me through, how did you come to change your mind? And ask questions.
Okay. Yeah, okay. I want to get back again to cult as a Trump figure. I'm very interested in the specifics of the dynamic between Trump the leader and his followers. Okay? You had said very early in our interview that people who, in effect, leave cults, or one way for people to leave cults, is to have interactions with people outside that are humane, supportive.
Yeah, the only people who leave cults without outside is if they're kicked out because they're asking questions that the cult leader doesn't like.
Well, I want to ask you a question again. It goes back again to the basic definition of the cult. When I think of the cult, and the techniques used, and I think this is probably true of your own experience, is we think of cults as deliberately segregating and cloistering followers from the outside world. One of the techniques is to break off relations with your family. When I think of the Branch Davidians, and of course the prime example of this is Jim Jones living in the outback of Guyana, and so on and so forth, you're separated from the outside world. However, Trump's base that lives in Appalachia, okay, and so on and so forth, is not cut off from the outside.
Oh, I hear you loud.
Let me finish my point. These are people who have social relations, who live in basically economic and social networks. They go to work. Their kids go to school, and they belong to the PTA, and they stop in at the library occasionally. They watch a diversity of TV shows, not only Fox News. They live in the world as you live in the world. Now, we may, in effect, right, they don't live in the cosmopolitan, ethereal atmosphere of New York City, but they have social relations of different types. Okay, and I think it's wrong to centralize people and say that people who live in the outback, when you meet somebody who plays the classical flute or violin, who lives in a hamlet of 80 people in Arkansas, you begin to get a different sense of diversity.
I totally agree.
Okay, so the question I'm asking is, given that the stereotype, maybe I'm wrong here, that the stereotype assumption of a cult is that people are separated from the rest of the world, cults that Trump's followers are not separated from the rest of the world. They live, their mindset may be focused more narrowly than yours or mine in many ways, but they have social relations and their lives are multi-layered in many different ways. So again, this is a question of definition as well as a definition of social control. If indeed these people do live in the world, how indeed does that fit into the stereotype definition of the cult, which perhaps I erroneously assume involves segregation from the
right. So yes, it is an erroneous.
Am I being clear about the question?
Absolutely. Okay. I think that the main cult leaders that you referenced, Jim Jones, when I was in the Moonies, David Koresh, for the most part, there was a physical isolation.
What's different is the internet and talk radio and media, like TV, has been taken over for propagandistic purposes. And again, for me, so my definition of a destructive cult is an authoritarian pyramid structured group that uses deception and mind control, behavior control, information control, thought control and emotional control to make people dependent and obedient. Okay, that's my definition back to 1988 of a group. It can be a religious cult, a political cult, a therapy cult, a large group awareness training cult, a multi-level marketing, could be traffickers, etc. Could be a government, could be North Korea, could be China. What's different now is we have cell phones that most people are using, and we're plugged in to our sources of information. Has everybody heard of a group called Better Angels? Look it up. There was just an article in the New York Times about it. It's an organization. I love what they're doing. They're bringing Republicans and Democrats together in groups to interact with each other and to listen to each other. It's such an essential part of how we're going to correct what's been happening in our country is breaking down the silos. Now, when analyzing somebody who's in a locale, a lot of the people that I've talked to who are Trump believers have said to me, my family won't talk with me. I can't have an intelligent conversation anymore because they yell at me and they call me names. Which I think is a shame. Like, talk and look for common ground. Chapter 9 is all about what I'm recommending that people do to start breaking through the shell of this certitude that somehow there's a deep state and there's this conspiracy and Trump's going to wipe away all the corruption and get rid of all the trafficking. I'm working with a woman right now, a master's degree IT person, who believes in QAnon. And she was a Bernie supporter. And she's completely, in that mindset, except she loves her husband, and they have two kids together, so she's willing to talk to me. She's willing to read my stuff. QAnon. QAnon is another group that it's a conspiracy theory online
group that says that there'll be 100,000 arrests and Trump's going to wipe away all the corruption and expose the international trafficking network that the Clintons, you know, did. Pizzagate, etc. The group is still around, unfortunately. But yes, we're living in the digital age and you no longer need to be physically cloistered to be in a mind control cult.
Right.
There are many people who are in mind control cults who go to work every day and they watch TV at night, but they can't think critically about their leader, the doctrine, or the group. They can't talk to their best friends who've left the group, or they may not be able to talk to their own family members who are still in the group. And it's this information control that's a major feature of mind control.
It's very interesting. So you're saying that one does not have to be physically separated, that we've created virtual separation.
Right. And that the cults want to trigger the family and friends to give up on their loved ones. So when Scientologists do their communications course where they're learning to stare at a member and everything else, the next one is called bull baiting, where the Scientologist will say, and you're in a cult, aren't you? In order to get the Scientologist not to react. So that when their family members say, you're in a cult, look at the Leah Remini show, the person is like, I don't need to look at the Leah Remini show. I know this is really working for me.
Right. Okay, a few more questions.
Please.
We'll have to have to. This is really, really very interesting. It's very important. When you talk about remediations and people leaving cults, your response, as indeed your analysis, is primarily psychological and interpersonal.
Mm-hmm.
That you use. And yet, I can't get away from the fact, and I tend to be more sociologically oriented and politically oriented, that so much of what we're seeing in terms of Trump's followers has to do with the fact, it's not the only dynamic, the fact again that the doors of economic opportunity are closed to people, the economy has changed in ways that people can't adapt, you're not going to get a 50-year-old guy whose factory is closed to retool himself in IT technology to find a new job, that there's a great deal of despair. And we know the extreme of that is what we now call deaths of despair, suicide, alcoholism, 40,000 people dying of opioid addiction, and so on and so forth. I can't look at those phenomena and say that there is not that I'm a Marxist, but that there is in fact an economic base to so much of the problems that we're looking at that tend to condition, not an economic determinist, but I think economics conditions and molds people's values and so forth. And I'm wondering, it doesn't factor into your approach, which is psychological and interpersonal, with regard to getting people out of this situation.
Yep.
I look towards economic and political remedies and say that if indeed we could restore a more egalitarian economy and open the doors again for political advancement so people felt that they, and particularly their children, can move up, mm-hmm. that would go far in terms of undoing the type of psychological grip that the cultic phenomenon, which you analyze, it's your business to do that analysis, that the cultic phenomenon has indeed imposed. And I'm wondering how you look at those other dynamics in terms of your analysis.
How I think about it is, and I'll borrow on my friend who's Alan Shefflin, who's a law professor emeritus from Santa Clara University, who created a social influence model for expert witnesses to use in courts of law that look at the influencee, the influencer, and the goals, the methods of influence to analyze whether there is undue influence being used. And there's no question that there are economic vulnerabilities if you're out of work and someone's offering you hope that you're going to get money or you're going to get a job. That's going to be a major susceptibility in terms of influence. I'm completely for more egalitarian economic approaches, but I don't see a way out of this without people understanding psychology, understanding themselves, understanding how the mind works, understanding
the difference between ethical influence that's giving you a real choice, but respecting your individuality, your right to question, and reality test, versus the fear indoctrination, the thought-stopping indoctrination, the trust me, the loyalty and obedience over your own conscience and your own reality testing. It's very interesting that in the last couple of weeks, Anthony Scaramucci has been interviewed recently, saying that Trump is like a cult leader, Hubbard, and talking about the GOP needing deprogramming. And I spoke with him on Friday, actually, and he read the Cult of Trump book. And so I'm like, so what's your plan? He said, you should, let me interview you, Steve. I was like, okay, let me know. We'll do it. But the point is we need Republican, conservative, respected voices, and ideally more insiders, to be able to speak out to their groups, the Republican organization. And in my research, people tend to vote whatever party they grew up in. Whether you're a Democrat, you vote Democrat or Republican. We need to start thinking more about issues and substance. And in my last chapter, I talk about the need to, I think, psychologically certify anyone who's going to occupy the White House to have at least some basic sound mental health, like a forensic evaluation. Seriously, because think about it. If you're a nuclear sub, you get tested every year to be around nuclear weapons. Except if you're in the White House, you don't need to have any testing. You can blow up the world. You can do a one-sided nuclear attack, and there's nothing to stop you. And that's scary.
Okay, Steve, I want to give you the last word, of course. We have to bring this to a close. It's been a great discussion. It's a great book. By the way, it's a great survey also about the whole scope of the Trump phenomenon and the broad reach that he has into other organizations and support. So beyond your central analysis, there's a lot of really very rich material. However, there is one issue with which I must say I disagree.
Okay.
I love the book on the other side, but I have trouble with one point that you raised. And it's on page 225, and I'll read the short paragraph, which I have some real trouble with. Now, I do agree that freedom of religion has been exploited by the Christian right, particularly, to basically expand the power of religion into the public square and into politics. I look at the Charitable Choice Initiative and government giving large grants of money. James Madison is turning over his grave. Large amounts of money. We are destroying the separation of church and state, brick by brick, and Christian right is doing it. However, I must say, I do value and cherish the right of religious freedom at the same time. The question is, the boundaries have shifted too far in one direction. But I'm not only basically support the establishment clause, I also support the free exercise clause, including for people who have beliefs that are totally different from
me too,
and which I may find in many ways reprehensible.
Yep.
And after all the historical religions are patriarchal, which is something I oppose, and yet I support the right of the Catholic Church not to ordain women as priests, if that's indeed they're still private organizations.
And people are free to leave.
As long as you can leave, as long as there's an exit, however difficult it is for women, I in fact will support the right of religious freedom and approves to behave as they will. This is the point where I have a little bit of difficulty, okay? You say, a final note on the subject of religion. I believe that tax-exempt status, by the way, the Ethical Culture Society of Taxes, I believe that tax-exempt status should not be granted to just any group that says they are a religious organization. Okay, a red flag goes up to me in my mind, because I ask myself, who is to make that judgment if we're going to sustain religious freedom and we take it very seriously? Then you then go on to say, I would like to see a governmental body set up that acts as a consumer clearinghouse, link the FBI and the IRS, that has the power to investigate and prosecute any tactics that prove or any entity that systematically violates people's rights. Now, you don't mean, of course, you mean their civil liberties in the public domain. You can't mean their equality within the context of a religious group.
Because
obviously religions can preach inequality within their group, and I don't want to do that. If such an entity is found to be deceptively recruiting, okay, thereby violating people's civil or religious rights, okay, well, are they violating their civil rights? Or to be using high pressure methods of mind control to keep them from seeking the health or education they need, and so on and so forth. You know, from the point of view of a militant atheist, all the recruiting techniques of the religions are deceptive. I mean, this again is questions of definition that will protect, I think, the need to protect religious freedom. I had the other day a 20-minute conversation with a Lubavitch. I don't know why I spent 20 minutes talking to him. He's a nice guy. He's telling me that Menachem Schneerson is going to rise from his grave in Queens, and that I should go down. I should go down to 770 Eastern Parkway and talk to the Rebbe's. The group is split between the fact that he's the Messiah and he's not Messiah. I should talk to the pro. He was the pro Messiah king. I should talk to the right Rebbe's there. Okay, I could argue in terms of trying to sell me this mythology. And recruiting, which he was trying to do, he was being deceptive. He's getting, if I use a rational, if I use a rational analysis, and rationalist I am, in effect, all of religion, we might argue, is deceptive. And the question I would say is, if you're going to deny a group its status of religion, who is to make that judgment? The FBI? I mean, our government bureaucrats are not theologians.
Right.
And you're basically putting them in that position. That makes me, I've got to tell you, Steve, that makes me uncomfortable if you want to preserve the right to religious freedom.
Thank you.
And I'm not going to get, I mean, I may be biased.
No, and thank you for disagreeing, and questioning is healthy.
Okay.
I come to my opinion and conclusions based on having been in a cult, being a mental health professional, and working in this field for 43 years. I state again, and I should say I'm a member of a Renewal Jewish Temple in Brookline, Massachusetts for 21 years, and I like to go to Torah study, and I like to daven, and I do drive on Shabbat, so I'm not Shomar Shabbat, but I believe in religious freedom. That said, the reason I'm in a doctoral program at 65 years of age is because I realized a number of years ago that as an activist, nothing's changing. In fact, things are getting worse. And I realized that what needs to change is the law needs to be updated from a 100-year-old outdated model that says human beings are rational agents and all you need to do is be 18 and you're making your own decisions. Now we know with cognitive neuroscience, the frontal cortex isn't even mature till 25, just to use one little variable. But so this model that I mentioned about predator and influencer and influencee, my model of the influence continuum and the bite model, I'm doing quantitative scientific research to show that these are the four major components of how to analyze any relationship or group in terms of whether or not it's supporting people's ability to individuate as an adult, capable of making your own decisions, having your own thoughts, and making choices. Now, when you're in a group that has a manual that says, don't lie, you know, most people won't lie. If you have a manual that says, hey, everyone's satanic and you need to lie, as it was in the moon cult, that's a real difference. I think that group shouldn't be subsidized by our tax dollars to harm people's human rights. And I think there needs to be some type of reality testing mechanism that doesn't give people a free pass. If they say, oh, I heard it from God, or my minister told me to do this, that holds them accountable. And I think money, and you mentioned economics, is a major driver of human behavior. I agree. And if organizations knew, like the Jehovah's Witnesses, I didn't learn this initially, but when they go door to door and they say, how do you want to study the Bible with you, they're not using the same book as everybody else. They have their own version called the New World Translation that no Jewish or Christian theologian says is accurate.
So when people think they're studying the Bible, they're not even looking at the King James or something that other Christians know about. So thank you for disagreeing.
Perfect.
It's really a wishful think that I added this to the book, that to have some type of mechanism where people who've been raped by their cult leader or deceptively recruited should be able to go to a judge and a jury and say, Your Honor, stop this, you know, malevolent behavior that's harming so many people. If we love freedom, if we believe in democracy and the separation of church and state, we are in a battle in that sense of saying facts matter, democracy matters, checks and balances, rule of law matters. And having conversations with people who think that Trump is above the law and doesn't need to respond to congressional subpoenas, and his people don't need to respond to congressional subpoenas.
Yes. Well, one last word briefly. Are you hopeful?
I have to be hopeful. That's how I think about it. We're living in a historical moment, and I have to believe that there are good people who aren't frozen or checking out or so traumatized, but actually are activists and want to rescue our experiment in democracy in the United States and have racial equality and economic equality and liberty and, you know, salute to, you know, fighting the global climate lobby that's promulgating, you know, wishful thinking for their own greed. Instead of thinking about our future, we live on one planet together. So we need to come together. And I love this, the work that you're doing to be inclusive, to promote critical thinking. You're the only organization that's offered to have me come and speak about this book. Honestly, where are all the other organizations? Where are all the other TV shows talking about mind control?
Right?
It's too hot a subject, apparently, for people to think about.
Steve, I want to thank you on behalf of all of us for the very important work you do.